Hey guys, good morning. Hey, it's good to see everybody at church today. If we have not met yet, my name is John and I serve here as the campus pastor, and I certainly hope that you felt welcomed as you entered church today. And we also hope, it's our hope that you are impacted by our service today that we have planned and prayed over. I just want to say it's really good to be back. It's really good to see you guys. I have been sick for the last 20 or so days. Melissa and I went with Pastor Monet and the high schoolers to Camp Harvest. And to be honest, we always expect some sort of fatigue from camp because we're not 15 or 20 anymore, you know? And we're not also not surprised to get sick because when you are stuck with 15 people in a small cabin for 5 days, there is a high potential to get sick. So the good news is that my wife, Melissa, did not get sick. I got it for the both of us. So it got me pretty good, but I'm back and I'm feeling really good. I have a lingering cough, so if I cough this morning, I apologize. But I missed you guys. There's nothing like being with God's people in the Lord's house, right? Amen. All right. Hey, if you have a Bible, turn to Psalm 128. Psalm 128. We have been in this short series that we're going to actually close out today called Ascent. And we have been looking at a few of the Psalms of Ascent, which stretch from Psalm 120 to Psalm 134. And these songs that are found in the book of Psalms are essentially ritualistic songs that the people of God would sing on their way to Jerusalem, to meet with God. This journey, this trek, this pilgrimage was very hard and very tough. And so they would sing these songs to God, but they also would sing these songs to one another. They would sing these songs to one another to remind and encourage each other what God has done, what he is doing, and what he will do. Now, this might sound a little familiar. This is for free. You guys like free stuff? Okay, yeah, me too. This is for free, ready? Well, everything at church should be free today. This is what we do every single Sunday morning. Like one non-negotiable for us here at Harvest every Sunday morning is that we sing songs of worship. Like the worship team, they planned every single week songs to, yes, sing to God, truths about God. But here's a really cool thing about worship too, and I felt like we just all experienced it here in these last few moments. We're actually singing to each other. Like we're singing to each other to remind ourselves of the truths that are found in God's word and also what's to come in the future, the hope that we're holding on to, the promises that our God, our great God, has promised us. We're singing those actually to each other, but yes, to God, as we all are on this journey through the Christian life here together. So today, we're actually ending our series. And before we get to Psalm 128, this past week, I did a research on what the ultimate human achievement would be. Okay, I did a research on what's the greatest, highest achievement a human being can find. And as you can guess, when you research anything like that on Google, you're going to find all sorts of kind of answers and things. And so by far, I mean, there's a lot of things, right? Like wealth, security, popularity, positive vibes in your life, okay? That's millennials, okay? So, and Gen Z. But by far, the number one human achievement that I found, the common thread through all my research, was happiness. Fulfillment, satisfaction, a blessed life. Now, if I were to ask anybody in here, you don't have to raise your hand, but if I were to ask you, do you want a fulfilled life? Do you want a happy life? Do you want a blessed life? None of us would say no. We're like, yes, I'm in. Wow, is that a trick question, Pastor John? Like, that's a silly question. Of course, I want a blessed and happy life. And so I continued in my research down the Google rabbit hole and looked up how to find happiness. Like, what is it that can make me happy? And so as I researched, and I found one blog that had a lot of hits and a lot of comments. So I'd like to read to you the top 10 ways that you can find ultimate happiness and fulfillment in life. Buckle up. Here we go. All right, here we go. One, practice smiling, because when you tend to smile, you're happy. Okay. Exercise. Number two, exercise. 7 minutes could be enough. Okay. Get plenty of sleep. Who finds some happiness in sleep? Raise your hand. Okay, yeah, amen, all right? All the young families in here that have babies, you'll get there one day, okay? Spend more time with family and friends. It's a good one. Help and serve others. 100 hours a year is the magical number. Get outside more. Happiness is maximized at 57 degrees. Wow, that's specific and interesting. For a Southern boy, it's not 57 degrees. Go about 20 more up, okay? Number 7, breathe deeply. That you'll find happiness and fulfillment when you just breathe a little bit more. Number 8, acknowledge the unhappy moments in your life. Okay, identify, and that will get you on the road back to happiness. Number 9, meditate. And number 10, move closer to work. A short commute is worth more than the big house. And everybody in the West suburb said, amen. Okay, all right. Now, none of these things are in and of themselves terrible ideas. They're not inherently sinful, right? They could be helpful. But my question for this blogger, I didn't get into it because I don't feel like I need to pastor the internet. God called me to pastor a campus and a church. Is that where you're going to find ultimate fulfillment and happiness in your life? By doing those 10 things? Or is there another way? Or insert whatever you and I do to make us feel happy and try to find fulfillment. Relationships, technology, gadgets, stuff, materialism, wealth, gaining popularity, respect, climbing the corporate ladder. Will we ultimately find fulfillment and true happiness that God designed for us in those ways? And again, none of those things are inherently sinful, but can those things become the source of our ultimate happiness? Well, today, I'm going to make an argument from God's Word, the last song of ascent that we will look at today, that the blessed and happy and fulfilled life comes when we fear the Lord. That the blessed and the fulfilled satisfactory life is found when we fear the Lord. So that's my main idea. Here it is, ready? When we fear the Lord, He will bless our lives. When you and I fear the Lord, He will bless our lives. And so today I have a two-point sermon, okay? Two-point sermon, and then after that, we'll be done, okay? So let's look at this psalm, this wisdom psalm together. We'll start in verse 1. It's only 6 verses. It says this: Blessed is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in His ways. You shall eat the fruit of your labor of your hands. You shall be blessed, and it shall be with you. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children will be like olive shoots around your table. Behold, thus shall the man is blessed who fears the Lord. The Lord bless you from Zion. May you see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your life. And may you see your children's children. Peace be upon Israel. Amen. This is a super upbeat psalm. This is a song that they would sing on their way to Jerusalem. It's encouraging. Now, as I was studying this passage, clearly the theme, the subject of this whole psalm is blessing. He says it four times in the short 6 verses. But with blessing, there is a condition that we must fear the Lord. And also, as I was reading the psalm, I was just kind of agreeing. I'm like, yeah. Like, who wouldn't want a blessed life in the area of work or whatever you do? Who wouldn't want the Lord to bless the work of our hands? Who wouldn't want a blessed or happy, fulfilled family or relational life? Who doesn't want that? We all want that. And who doesn't want a blessed future? Like, those three examples of psalmist list, none of us in here are saying, no, I don't want that. I don't want that. No, give me all that. And here's the thing that I caught myself doing when I was reading and studying is that I was saying, yes, God, I want those things in my life, like most of us, all of us do, but I quickly skipped over verse 1. I quickly skipped over verse 1, which is the condition to have a blessed life. So how do we have this blessed, fulfilled life? Well, he says it in verse 1. Look back in verse 1. Blessed, or you could insert the word happy, or fulfilled, satisfactory life is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his ways. So my first point this morning, if you're taking notes on the app or wherever you take notes, is the fear of the Lord in my life. The fear of the Lord in my life. Now, before I unpack the blessing and what actually the fear of the Lord is, I have two things that I want to say real quick. What this psalm, and really the thread of Scripture, as you look at it as a whole, it is not advocating that if we fear and trust Jesus and obey God, that God is going to give us whatever he wants. He's going to give us all of our heart's desires, that he's going to make us super wealthy, that he's going to give us good health all the time, that he's going to give us more green lights than red lights, and he's going to give us close parking spot at Jewel Osco and Target, okay? That's not what this psalm is advocating. On the other hand, this psalm is also not advocating that we must fear and obey and trust Jesus to earn God's favor and love in our lives. That's not the gospel either. That's not the gospel either. The gospel is that once you trust, this is so important, that once you trust Jesus for your salvation, to be saved, once you trust Jesus and turn away from your sin, you are saved. You are saved. And yes, there's going to be many times where you're going to mess up. There's going to be times when you're soaring in life, and there's going to be valleys and times where you're going to turn away from the Lord. But God's love does not change based on our performance. He doesn't love us less when we're sinning. He doesn't love us more when we're killing it in life. That's not the gospel. That's not the gospel at all. God's love and commitment to us is not based on our performance. It's not. That's not the purity of the gospel. It's not a conditional love that God has for us. It's an unconditional love for us. And that's why the gospel is so sweet, right? That's why it's so amazing. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. So I like to say it like this. Our vertical relationship with God is not hinged on how we perform in life, because it's based on whose performance? Jesus. He did it all for us, and we trust and obey. But there are horizontal consequences in the decisions that we make. There's positive and there's negative. So what this psalm is saying, and really the whole thread of Scripture, when we come to passages like this that sounds like, if you just do this, God will give everything you want. What this psalm is saying, and this needs to be clear, is that the person who seeks to honor and obey God will experience blessing, joy, and fulfillment in some way. In some way. These examples that the psalmist gives are examples. They're not promises. Obviously, God is not going to, all of us in here, if we all fear the Lord and obey him, he's not going to make the work of our hand completely thrive, or we climb the ladder if that's a goal. Not everybody in here is going to be married. Not everybody in here is going to have kids or grandkids, right? Not everybody may have what we'd see in the world's eyes as a blessed and secure future. But in the psalmist's eyes, these are three examples where you can find blessing in here, okay? Does that make sense? Like, I'm not advocating for the prosperity gospel in here, but when we obey, when we obey and fear God, there is blessing, okay? Now, let's look at what exactly the fear of God is. Now, when I use the word fear, the amount of people in this room, there's probably all kinds of connotations to what that means. For you, maybe when you hear the word fear, you think about the home that you grew up in, where it was instilled in you, or maybe the work culture that you're in, where fear is the driving force to make people work hard, to show up on time, okay? That's not what it means to fear the Lord. So I want to unpack it. The first thing about the fear of the Lord is it's a fundamental idea in Scripture. This is not a one-off that you find in Psalm 128. It's a fundamental idea and a command that God has for his people. Here's a few verses on the fear of the Lord, okay? We'll have these on the screen. Proverbs 1:7 says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of all knowledge." Proverbs 9:10 says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of all wisdom." Psalm 33, verse 18 says, "Behold, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear him," meaning that God wants to bless those who fear him. God wants to bless those who revere him, who see God for who he is. All right? So here's what I want to suggest from Scripture. To fear the Lord is actually a good thing. It's a positive thing in the believer's life. It's not something where we need to cower back from God and be completely afraid. So here's our working definition that I came up with, what it means to fear the Lord, okay? We have this on the screen. To fear the Lord, it means to revere God in worship, worshipful obedience. To fear the Lord means to revere God in worshipful obedience. That's what it means to fear God. To fear God, it means to see God for who he is, which is holy, transcendent, set apart, sinless, different, other than us, way completely different than us. And it's supposed to make us tremble and be in awe and wonder. I was talking with one of our congregants outside today. How many of you guys have been to like a beautiful national park or some amazing scenery? Yeah, we're talking about the Grand Canyon. If you've been to the Grand Canyon, you get there and your jaw just drops because all of a sudden you see this big, beautiful ditch in the middle of Arizona. And you're just speechless. That's one aspect of the fear of God, is that when we see God's holiness and see his righteousness and justice and his perfect love and goodness, there's a sense of terror and awe and majesty. To fear God, to revere him, means to put God in a completely different category than you and I. It means that he's not a larger, bigger version than you and I. That's not what it means. To revere God means to put him in a completely different category. To fear God also doesn't mean to completely be afraid and scared of him, that he's going to destroy us. Now, that's part of it. That's definitely part of it. But it's the understanding that God is so set apart, he is so holy, that he would actually be perfectly just to wipe us out at any point, because we are not holy. So there's actually an amazing picture of this in the Bible, and it's in Isaiah. In Isaiah 6, Isaiah encounters the Lord for the first time. He encounters the Lord in a vision. And when he sees the Lord, Isaiah doesn't say, "What's up, God? How's it going? We're tight, right?" No, he doesn't say that. What does Isaiah say in Isaiah 6? He says, "Woe to me! I am a man of unclean lips. I am lost. I am a sinner." The very presence of God in Isaiah's life is revealed. And Isaiah, God didn't need to tell Isaiah, "You're a sinner, you're not holy." No, he felt it because he was in the very presence of God. That's one aspect of the fear of God. It's seeing or reading and seeing God for who he is. And there's a sense of tremble. There's a sense of, I am unworthy. I am undeserving to be in the presence of a holy and just God because he is perfect and I am not. But that's not the complete picture of the fear of God. There's another picture. If you've read Isaiah 6, you know what happens immediately following when Isaiah sees the Lord. What does the Lord do? He sends an angel to cleanse him of his sin and his unclean lips. You know what that's a picture of? The gospel. It's a perfect picture. It's a picture in the Old Testament of the gospel, where we are undeserving of anything good in our lives from God, to be in the presence of God, to be in the family of God, but yet God sends Jesus, he provides for us, and Jesus takes our place on the cross, and he cleanses us from our sins and makes a way back to God possible. So the fear of God is to understand that God is holy and we are not, and to come to the realization that we don't deserve to be in his presence, but God sends Jesus so that we could enter in relationship with him, so that we could know him, so that we can be in his presence and to be in his family. And all that God, if you are in Christ today, all that God has for you is blessing, joy, fulfillment, and grace and love. And he's preparing a place for us right now for us to be with him forever. I love how Tim Keller sums up the gospel. He says the gospel is that we are far more sinful and flawed in ourselves than we ever dare believe. Yet, at the very same time, we are more loved and accepted in Jesus Christ than we would ever dare. Amen? Amen. So when it comes to the fear of God, a true biblical understanding when it comes to the fear of God is on one hand, and the Bible has both of these in tension and balances both. Both are true. That there is a reverent awe and terror of God that we should have in our lives. A healthy respect and awe of God. But at the same time, he's made a provision for us in Jesus Christ. So a pastor put it like this. The posture of the believer when it comes to the fear of God is that we are face down before the cross of Jesus Christ, with our hand up in gratitude and humility and dependence on Jesus, saying, thank you, God, for making a way for me. And then God reaching down and saying, welcome to my family through my son, Jesus Christ. That's the picture of the fear of God. And when we have the fear of God, we are most blessed. And look back at verse one. Blessed is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his ways. So what does the fear of the Lord produce in us? Obedience, worshipful obedience, that we would walk in the commandments that God gives for us. And I want to suggest right now that when we walk in God's commandments that are not burdensome on us, that are not to kill our fun or joy, it's actually you'll find more joy and fulfillment when you do things God's way. Like when we take matters in our own hands, When we lie, when we talk falsely or gossip about each other, that breaks relationship, yes, with God, but it breaks relationship with each other. I'm not saying that if you follow all God's commandments that you're going to have this perfect life, but it's there that you're going to find true joy and peace in your life. I love how Paul David Tripp in his book, Age of Opportunity, describes the fear of the Lord and walking in his ways. He says this, to fear God means that my life is structured by a sense of awe, worship, and obedience that flows out of recognizing him and his glory. And he becomes, this is so important, to walk in his ways. And he becomes the single most important reference point for all that I desire, think, do, and say. God is my motive. God is my goal. The fear of God is meant to be the central organizing force in my life. I think about all the vehicles that you guys came into church in. Is that those vehicles in the cars are just cars, right? But it's not when someone turns on the car or pushes the button, whatever you have, and engage the gas pedal, that car will move forward. The fear of the Lord is the gas pedal. When you and I choose to fear the Lord and press that gas pedal, our lives start moving in the direction where we can receive blessing. And so do you press that gas pedal in your life? Do you fear the Lord? Is there a sense of awe of who God is? A sense of, I am so undeserving of your love and presence, God. But through Jesus Christ, I am accepted. I am secure. I am loved. Do you have a fear of God in your life? Have you come to that realization? To fear the Lord means to walk in his ways. And to walk in his ways, it's played out every day. It's not just a one-time decision. In the decisions that you make in your life, in all aspects of your life, we need to ask ourselves, will this bring God the most glory if I choose this road and choose this path? If I do this, if I go this way, if I say this, will it honor and please God? To be honest, I wish it was more true of my life. I don't think it surprises anybody in here that I am not a perfect person, that I have plenty of struggles in my life. And I mean, oh my goodness, if we could spend here all day just going through my flaws and what I need to struggle with. But I want to get honest with you. One area of struggle in my life, you ready? Is when I respond to someone when they tail or honk or cut me off in driving. Anybody in here struggle with that? Come on, safe place. Okay, if your hand's not up, someone's probably, all right. So here's the story. Yesterday, I'm driving here in the morning, and I'm on Deer Path by Herget, and I'm getting close past the middle school, if you know where Herget is, and there's five cars in front of me, and I see this car that's coming quickly upon me, okay? And they get really close to me, a little red sports car, okay? So I feel like they're tailing me a little bit, and I'm like, you know what? Let me check the rearview mirror. Let's get a perspective on this, you know? Like, I don't want to blow it out of proportion. And so he, sure enough, he's tailing me. And then the guy throws up his hands in the air, okay? Like, who are you to drive the speed limit? I'm like, I don't know. The government told me to, you know? Like, what do you want me to say, you know? And so what I do in those moments, in my flesh, I take the opportunity to teach them a patience lesson, and I just pump tap the brakes a little bit, and say, "Oh, game on!" And I slow down below the speed limit. My wife hates that, but my flesh loves it. Okay. So while this is happening, I'm listening to verses on the fear of the Lord, and this is such a God moment. Here's the verse and chapter that I'm hearing while this is happening, while I'm acting sinfully in my flesh. Proverbs 14, verses 16 and 7. The one who is wise and cautious and turns away from evil, the fool that is reckless and hot-headed, careless, a man of quick temper acts foolishly. So he tells me, and so I slow down, and we get to the stop sign. And he comes up right next to me. He rolls out his window, and he yells something at me, probably like, "God bless you." No, it wasn't that. It was definitely not that. Definitely wasn't that. It was something else that you cannot say, okay? And so I don't roll my window down, but I say something like, "Oh, really? You wanted me to go faster? Did you not see the five cars in front of me? So you literally wanted me to drive 1 or 2 miles per hour to catch up to the rest of the cars in front of me so that you could get to your stop sign 2 seconds faster. Really?" And I thought, as soon as I heard that, as soon as I said that, I thought, oh, God. I just literally heard a verse about a quick, hot-tempered man acting foolishly. And I thought to myself, and I prayed to God, I said, "God, I have so many areas of growth, obviously. But I don't want that to be true of me." It's like Paul in Romans 7. He says, I know what's right. I know God's law and commandments, but I do what I don't want to do. And it's so true in the life of the believer. Listen, I think it's so important that we unpack this part of the fear of the Lord. Because I don't want anybody in here to have just a sense of, I need to be afraid of God. You know, what the fear of the Lord actually does, it draws us into Him. It draws you to Him. It doesn't deteriorate and deteriorate you from Him. You see, yes, those of us who have chosen to fear the Lord and trust Christ, we will walk in His ways. But there's going to be moments, just like me, here in this silly story that's true, where we're going to stumble, when we're going to blow it, when we will mess up. But listen, the fear of the Lord draws us in because we know that we can ask the Lord for forgiveness. We can restore that relationship. Even though we broke fellowship with the Lord in these momentary times in our life, He still is calling us to Himself. So the fear of the Lord actually draws us into Him, to be with the Father. I think about this when I was growing up. I had the privilege of growing up in a God-fearing, loving home. When I was a child, I didn't fear my father in a sense that he would crush me if I did something wrong, although he could because he was bigger and stronger. Still is today, just a little bit older. I didn't fear that he would crush me even though he could. But I feared to disappoint him. I feared that when I sinned and messed up and disobeyed him, that it would break our relationship. And honestly, it took me a long time. And my mom and dad didn't instill this in us, but it took me a long time to come to the realization that I actually can run and go back to my father and mom and admit my failures and disobedience, and that there'd be forgiveness. and that we could go on with our relationship. Yes, there were consequences. Yes, they didn't spare the rod for sure on me, right? But that didn't change their love and commitment to me. That didn't change that I was their child. None of that changed. And I think that's the same way with God. The picture of fearing the Lord is you can run to God still when you mess up, because we have the confidence, as Hebrews 4 says, we can approach the throne of God in boldness and in confidence. In 1 John 1, it's that when we confess our sins, God is just and faithful to forgive us and cleanse us all of our sin. Does that make sense? The fear of God, we can run back to God. We don't have to cower and hide like Adam and Eve did in Genesis 3. God has made a provision. So that's the fear of the Lord in my life. Okay, that's my first point. Some of you guys are like, that was just verse 1. You got 5 more to go, Pastor. Yeah, buckle up. We're not even halftime. I'm kidding. Okay. Point 2, my final point here. Okay, my final point this morning. The Lord's favor in my life. The Lord's blessing, the Lord's favor in my life. Let's unpack this, okay? I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the last 5 verses, because verse 1 is the focus, and the rest of the verses are really not. They're examples, okay? So the psalmist gives a few examples of where we can fear the Lord and where we could find blessing, okay? And I think a lot of these will apply to us in here. First, okay, we don't have these on the screen, but there's 2 things. First, he blesses the work of our hand. God wants to bless the work of our hand. I'm guessing every single person in this room, as we gathered here to church today, you want God to bless your efforts. You want God to bless the work of your hand. You're not doing it for anything, nothing, but you want God to see your hard work that you're doing unto him and find blessing and fulfillment. And that's a good desire. So I'll just speak for me. I want God's blessing in my life as your pastor. So my prayers in my life is this: God, I am so humbled that you have given me this opportunity to pastor and love this campus. In and of myself, I don't have the strength. I don't have the power. I don't have the capacity. And all that, I don't even deserve it. Who am I, God, that you would give me this wonderful gift of Harvest Aurora? God, I pray that you would open our eyes to the truth of your word, that you would unite this campus around the cross of Jesus Christ, that you would raise up this next generation to love and behold the gospel, that all the leaders and volunteers that it takes to run a campus like this, that you would give them strength, that you would give them rest, and that they would abide in you. But God, before I can even ask those things, I know that I need to fear you first. I know that I need to abide in you, Christ. I know that my source of strength and reliance and dependency needs to be on you, and I need to continually be in the posture of humility to before you. That's my prayer. So what are the spears in your life? Teacher, stay-at-home parent, attorney, financial advisor, student, plumber, white or blue collar, whatever it is. Do you fear the Lord in those opportunities when you're working hard? Like, we all want God to bless the work of our hands, but it comes when we fear the Lord and obey and honor his commandments. A few ways that this could look like. This is vague, okay? Because there's so many different people in this room this morning. But do you work heartily for the glory of the Lord in your job? You might have an amazing employer. They also might just be terrible. But do you seek to honor them because you know you're actually not working for them, but you're actually working for the Lord? Does that play out in how you speak of your employer behind their back? Do you encourage them? Do you lift them up? Do you care for them as you want to be cared for as an employer? Students, do you honor your teachers and your parents? What about this? Do you make high character decisions in your workplace? Because sometimes the temptation of cheating, cutting corners is very tempting and enticing. But do you at the end of the day say, you know what? There might be consequences to what I'm about to have to unpack this project or whatever, or make this decision, but I'm going to fear the Lord first, because that's where I'm going to find true fulfillment and blessing on my life, is when I fear the Lord and do what he calls me to do first. There's many other examples. So not only does God want to bless us and bless the work of our hand, but he wants to bless our relationships and families. That's number two. Verse 3 says this: your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children will be like olive shoots around your table. Behold, thus shall the man be blessed who fears the Lord. So as you and I, as we seek the Lord and as we abide in him, it's asking God something like this: God, would you bless my family as I fear you and as I obey you? Will you bless my marriage? Would you bless my kids? Would you give my family, my kids, a faith in you, a holy dependence upon you? And even though I don't know the outcomes, and even though I don't control their decisions to know you, I know this: when I fear you and obey you and set up a household, a home that is gospel-centered, that you're going to bless my family somehow. And that even if my kids reject the Lord and reject you, God, I know that what I can control is the legacy that I leave for them in faith in the gospel impact. It could look like that. I'm so thankful that I grew up in a home. I was telling someone this week, I'm so thankful that I grew up in a Christian home. My wife too, her family's here today, and I'm so glad you guys are here. We're blessed with that. I know some of you guys, that wasn't your reality, but I grew up in a home where my mom and dad feared the Lord, where they obeyed him, where they made a lot of decisions that sometimes didn't make sense to the world, but it made sense in God's eyes. And even if I wasn't a Christian, there was a clear example and legacy of faith that they left behind. And if God chooses to give Melissa and I kids in his plan, that's what we want. And if you're a parent in here, if you're married in here, it's not too late to desire and ask God to fear him and him bless that in your life. It's not too late. So men, love your wives. Love your wives. Sacrifice. Lay your life down for them. Cherish them. And you won't be perfect, but we have a perfect example. His name, Jesus. Love your wife as Christ loved his church. If you're married in here, ladies, love, submit, not because you're lesser, and encourage your husband. If you have kids, parents, sow into your kids. Sow and engage and invest in your kids' spiritual formation. Set your home up in a way that fears the Lord, that honors him, where they can see now, but maybe later, how the gospel impacted your home. And maybe you're here today and you're like, Pastor John, hardly any of these apply to me. Well, the good news is that this is a principle. The principle of all this is that whatever you do, whether you're single, have a family, or you don't have a family, if you have grandchildren or you don't have grandchildren, if you work or you don't work, in any decisions, aspects of your life, when you fear the Lord, he will shower his blessings upon you. And he'll give you true joy and true fulfillment. As I close, let's look at the final two verses in this. The psalmist ends with a benediction and a word of blessing for the people of God in those days. And this is how I'm going to close. The Lord bless you from Zion. May you see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your life. May you see your children's children. Peace be upon Israel. So as I close, that's my heart for us, that we would be a church, a campus, a people that is marked by the fear of the Lord, that we would obey and trust and go where God says go, that we'd seek to honor him in all our decisions as we are on this journey in our walk with Jesus Christ. And I truly believe, as we do this, not perfectly because no one's perfect, but as we walk in the ways of the Lord, by grace-driven effort, we'll see God's blessing and see true fulfillment and joy in our lives. Amen? Let's pray. God, that is my prayer, is that we would be marked as a campus that loves you, that we would see you, God, for who you are, holy, loving, gracious, kind. And yes, that strikes an awe in us. We're struck by your majesty and who you are, but that doesn't push us away from you, but that would actually draw us in, because we know and we're confident that Jesus didn't stay in the grave, but that you rose the third day, conquering sin and death. And that would continue to draw hearts. Maybe someone today will make that decision for the first time, but that those of us who placed our faith and trust in you, Jesus, that it would continually draw us back to you and say, yes, God, I'm going to say yes to you. And even though there could be consequences, negative consequences from the world's view, I'm trusting that I'm going to find true blessing and fulfillment and have the happiest life when I do it your way. So God, may that be true of us, and may that pour in to our homes, our marriages, our workplaces, our schools, and this community. In Christ we pray, amen.